Hello. In this video, we begin our study of linear operators between two normed linear spaces x and y. In particular, we consider a function or a mapping t from x to y. And this t is then called a linear operator if the mapping is linear in the standard sense, meaning that a linear combination of two elements x and y maps into a corresponding linear combination of the images tx and ty. The function t can in general be defined on a subspace dt of x, which is called the domain of t, and it consists of those x elements x for which the value tx is defined. In the case of linear operators, it's very common to use the notation tx without the parentheses, and we also follow this custom on our course. As our notation suggests, the matrix multiplication is one familiar example of a linear operator between two Euclidean spaces. And several other examples of linear operators arise in connection to other linear operations that can be performed, for example, for functions or for sequences. And these especially include differentiation and integration of functions, right and left shifting of sequences, or taking linear combinations of elements of a sequence. These examples are studied in greater detail in the lecture notes, and you can also find several other examples in the literature. In connection with linear operators, the concept of boundedness becomes very important and useful. And in particular, a linear operator is said to be bounded if there exists a constant m, such that for all x in the domain of t, the norms of the images tx are bounded from above by the constant m times the norm of x. And because of the scaling properties of the norm, boundedness can alternatively be defined as the property that the norms of tx must be uniformly bounded for all x with norms at most 1. And the boundedness of an operator really is a property of the operator, meaning that not all linear operators are necessarily bounded. But the linearity of the operator has very strong consequences when it comes to the continuity properties of the mapping T between the two normed spaces X and Y. And in particular, as the theorem stated here shows, this map T is continuous at some point X of the domain T, if and only if it is continuous and even uniformly continuous on all of the domain DT. And both of these properties are equivalent to the operator T being bounded. And this result explains why boundedness is such an important and perhaps the most frequently encountered property of linear operators, and also why bounded operators are sometimes referred to as continuous operators in the literature. On our current course, we'll focus mostly on properties of bounded operators, but we'll also encounter certain operators which are not bounded. And such unbounded operators are considered in greater detail on our later follow-up courses. As our first concrete example of a linear operator, we can choose x to be the space of continuous functions on a closed set omega of a Euclidean space. Take a fixed point z0 from inside omega, and we can then define an operator t z0, which for a given function f produces the value of f at the point zeta 0. Or we can alternatively say that this operator evaluates the function f at the point z0. The operator is then an operator from our space x of continuous functions to the space of complex numbers. It's also linear, since if we apply it to a linear combination of two functions f and g, then the way our addition and scalar multiplication are defined on C omega imply that the end result is the corresponding linear combination of the values of f and g at the point c0. And finally, the operator t0 is also a bounded operator, and we can see this by estimating the norm of tz0 f for an arbitrary f. And since the absolute value of f at c0 is always less than or equal to the supremum of the absolute values of the function f on all of omega, we can see that the modulus of tz0 f is always bounded from above by the infinity norm of f. By definition, this means that tz0 is bounded as an operator from x to the space of complex numbers, and the constant m in the definition of boundedness can in our case be chosen to be equal to 1. Now we can quickly take a look at a couple of other important classes of linear operators, which are studied in greater detail in the lecture notes, and which we'll also encounter several times throughout the course. If we consider x to consist of functions defined on a real interval, for example, either the Lebesgue space LP or the space of continuous functions on the closed interval, we can define a so-called integral operator on this space. And we can do this by taking a uniformly continuous function k of two variables, both on the interval from a to b, and by defining the operator t so that it is a function of t determined by an integration of a product of the functions k and f. And more precisely, for a given f, the value of this function tf at a fixed t is given as the integral of kt times s and f at s with respect to the variable s over the integral from a to b. And in our situation, the function k is called the kernel of the integral operator. And under our assumption that k is uniformly continuous, the integral operator we've defined here is defined on all of x, which means that its domain is equal to x, and it's both linear and bounded. Alternatively, we can consider differential operators. And if we again consider the space of functions of a single variable, we can define an operator t so that for a given function f, the value tf is a function which is the derivative of f of a given order here, for example, the first order or the second order. And since it's not possible to differentiate all functions in our space x, we need to choose a suitable domain for T. For our spaces of functions, we could choose the domain to be the space of continuous functions with the same number of continuous derivatives as our operator uses. And for both of these choices shown here, the operator T is well defined, since for every f in the domain of T, the image TF clearly belongs to the space X. In choosing the domain of an operator, one good rule of thumb is to try to make the domain DT as large as possible so that the images TF still belong to the to our intended space. But there are still a few important exceptions to this as well. In our case, if the space X is the space of continuous functions, we can see that our domains here are indeed perfectly suitable, since C1 and C2 are the largest subspaces of the space X, so that the function TF still belongs to X. On the other hand, if X would be the Lebesgue space LP, we could still use the domains shown here, because the images TF still belong to our space, but there would also be larger options available, namely the so-called Sobolev spaces of orders 1 and 2. One particularly important feature of these differential operators and differential operators more generally is that they tend to be in fact unbounded operators. The fact that they are not bounded follows from the fact that it's not possible to choose the constant m in the definition of boundedness. And we can show this by considering especially highly oscillatory functions such as sines or cosines. And for these types of functions, thus we have that the size of the derivative of the function is not bounded uniformly with respect to the values of the functions. And this ultimately leads to the conclusion that the norms of TF on X cannot be bounded by any constant times the norm of F on X. Here it's important to note that the choices of the spaces and the norms makes a big difference when it comes to the boundedness of an operator. And it's in particular quite possible, in our example, to redefine our differential operators so that they become bounded operators simply by choosing the spaces and the norms of this on the spaces in a suitable way. And we can do this by instead defining our operators as operators directly from our domain that we had for our operator, and by choosing a suitable modified norm on the domain. But still, this modification doesn't really change any real properties of the operators, and it's much more common to consider differential operators as mapping from a space X into the same space X. And this is because for certain purposes, it's necessary that the two spaces X and Y of the linear operator are the same space. And one such instance is the study of the so-called spectrum of an operator, which is only defined for operators mapping from a space X back to X.